So let's say that you've gone off your birth control, you've tried for a few months, up to several months, and it's not happening for you. Are there things that a woman should talk with a doctor about at 6 months versus a year?
You know, I think if at 6 months you've been trying, you've tried, you know, little tips and things and tried tracking your periods and it just doesn't seem to be happening, I definitely think that's a good time to go ahead and come on in. And at that point, we may not start with a bunch of testing or anything like that, because like I said, still, you know, about 30% of people might get pregnant again in the next 6 months. So at that point, I'd say bring it in, bring in your period tracker, bring in your partner, let's talk about everything. And a lot of times we can find a little thing. So, you know, I'll talk to people and we'll talk about, okay, yeah, your cycle isn't that 28-day cycle. Your cycle is 32 based on your period tracker. So actually you're missing your ovulation window by a few days, and just kind of redirect them there. Doing the little things like keeping the laptop off your lap and those kinds of things, we can kind of go over all of that and talk about those little tips that may help you get pregnant in the next few months without any medications or assistance or
education.
Anything like that. Yeah, so yeah. Just some basic education stuff to go over. Make sure you're taking your prenatal vitamin. Make sure if you do have other medical problems that they're under control. So we can kind of talk about, you know what, okay, you know, you haven't gotten pregnant yet, but let's look at this medication that you're on, and it may not be causing infertility, but maybe it's not the safest one for you to be on right when you get pregnant. So maybe making some small adjustments like that too can be helpful. And then, like I said, let's go over your exercise routine, your diet. Let's talk about those kinds of things. Let's talk about some of those modifiable risk factors that we can potentially help with. And I think that just kind of gives people tips. But if you've done all that and now we're at a year, now we're at a year. At that point, let's talk about some testing options, okay? So at this point, like I talked about, the vast majority of couples should have been able to conceive spontaneously, okay? But some people are just not going to be there yet. And if that's the case, let's go over it. So I will kind of go into your cycle a little bit more. Let's hear about what's going on there. We'll talk again to him about some of the things that he's doing and see what's going on there. But the testing that we get into at this point, we'll do some testing really to look for other baseline medical problems that you might not know you have. So undiagnosed diabetes can actually make it really hard to get pregnant. Undiagnosed thyroid disorders or uncontrolled thyroid disorders can also make it really hard to get pregnant. So a lot of times we'll look for those things. There are also things you can have an issue with, a hormone called your prolactin, which is actually the hormone that helps you breastfeed. But if that hormone gets too high, it's actually telling your body that, hey, you're breastfeeding, you don't need to get pregnant. And so that actually can disrupt your ability to get pregnant. So looking for some of those baseline medical problems that you might have that are doing it. And then also looking at some of your cycle hormones and seeing what's going on there. Are you having some unbalances there that may be leading to you having trouble ovulating normally and having a normal cycle? And so that's kind of the lab work that we would do, the blood work. And then after that, there's some other testing that we can do. We do something we call a hysterosalpingogram, big fancy word, HSG, is much easier to say. So we do something called an HSG. And what that is actually where we'll actually shoot dye through your cervix and into your uterus while we take x-rays, okay? And what that does is that actually lets the dye kind of define what the inside cavity of your uterus looks like, and then also importantly see that that dye goes out your fallopian tubes.
There's no blockages or like roadblocks, and that could be the reason why sperm and egg haven't been able to meet up.
Exactly. Yeah. So we want to make sure, you know, when you're talking about normal female anatomy, you have your uterus, and then you have two fallopian tubes that come out on the other side, and those meet up with your ovaries. Your ovaries are where you ovulate, and then that egg has to travel all the way through the tube and into the uterus. So for any reason that connection isn't what it needs to be, you're going to have trouble. So that's one of the things we look for as well, to see if there's anything going on there. We can also look to make sure that the shape of your uterus is fairly normal. So you can actually have some issues where the shape of your uterus isn't normal. That usually doesn't lead as much to problems with fertility, but it can lead to problems with miscarriage.
Yeah.
Exactly. So we can kind of investigate both of those things at the same time, which is helpful. And then one of the other tests that we do, like we talked about 50% of the time, it's not just the woman, okay? And so we can also do things like semen analysis, examining the sperm, and we look at actually a ton of things with the sperm. So it's not just count, it's motility, it's shape, it's how liquidy or viscous the sperm is. It's all kinds of things to try and see, okay, is there a reason why the sperm can't get up there? Because the sperm is actually supposed to meet the egg in the tube. So that's quite a little swim for them. So we've got to make sure that they're all doing what they need to do as well. And if we do run into an issue where it is a problem with the sperm count, at that point we can get you where you need to be. So we can do things like refer you to an infertility specialist, which is called a reproductive endocrinologist and infertility specialist. Okay, these are people who are board certified in infertility. So they were gynecologists like me, and then they went to further study and further certification in order to become an infertility specialist. So we can get you there, and those people can help get you past some of those borders to having the sperm meet the egg. And so they can go through that with you. Sometimes we can also get you in with a urologist to see if there's an issue that urology can help out with to help the sperm come out better and see if there's a physical issue there. So sometimes there's an issue where there might be an anatomical problem within the scrotum that sometimes is easily fixed that can kind of help as well. So doing those little things to attack kind of that male factor of infertility. And then on my side, kind of helping with some of the female factor infertility is we can kind of see, let's say your HSG comes back abnormal. Let's say one of those tubes is blocked, okay? At that point, you know, it may be further evaluation with something like an ultrasound to see if there's something else going on. Sometimes if that tube is overly dilated and filled with fluid, that actually can be causing issues with fertility because the fluid in the tube gets kind of stale, for lack of a better word, and then that fluid kind of pours into the uterus and flushes the uterus on a regular basis, so you can't have implantation like you'd like. And so sometimes we can do little things, sometimes they're surgical, in order to get that under control. And then the last thing would be if it's a cycle issue. Okay, so we look, all of your hormones are showing us that your cycle's not normal, or maybe we've gotten to that point, everything so far looks normal, okay? So either we've run into an issue where we think maybe it's ovulation, or we haven't found an easy solution yet. Usually the next thing that we do is we do try to work on your ovulation and help you ovulate better, okay? So that's usually a medication. The medications that most physicians start with is a medication called Clomid or a medication called Femara, okay? They both do very similar things. And basically what they're both meant to do is to help you ovulate, okay? So usually these are medications that you're gonna take in the first few days of your cycle. Remember, day one is the first day you bleed, okay? So at least for me, the way I typically start with Clomid, and we usually start that on day three of your cycle. Okay, so first day is the day you bleed, and then on day three you start your Clomid, and you take that every day at about the same time every day for 5 days. And then after that, we usually recommend that you start having sex about 5 days after that, and do that every other day for about a week, okay? Expecting that ovulation is gonna be somewhere around day 14, like we talked about earlier. Usually, when we're doing Clomid, it is really important that we check a progesterone level, and we do that around day 21. The reason we do a progesterone level at day 21 is because that's when your progesterone should spike if you have ovulated. Okay, so if you ovulated at day 14, that progesterone level should continue to rise and reach its peak around day 21. Okay, so day 21 lets me know, okay, if your progesterone level falls in the right range, you have hopefully ovulated, which means hopefully you'll get pregnant this cycle, okay? And so, and again, we're talking about pregnancy rates around 20% still, even with Clomid. The pregnancy rate is still only about 20%, so we can take several cycles, okay?
And up to how many cycles should someone try a medication?
And I think that varies a little from physician to physician. I would say most physicians will do somewhere between about 4 and 6 cycles. So I usually tell people, once I get you to a dose of Clomid that works, and there are only 3 doses of Clomid, 50, 100, and 150, we only go up if you don't ovulate. We don't go up just because you didn't get pregnant, okay? So if we know you're ovulating, there's no reason to give you a higher dose of the drug that can potentially give you more side effects. So the other thing to keep in mind when you're taking Clomid is it is a medication, so there's certainly some side effects with that that your doctor can go over with you. But one of the important ones to think about is it actually increases your risk for multiples. Exactly. So it can increase that risk of twins up to like 5 to 9%. And it increases that risk of triplets up to about 0.5%.
Which sounds small, but we see it all the time, right, in our
exactly,
field.
Exactly, yeah. Unfortunately, triplets become a little more scary when you're talking mm-hmm. about something like this. And obviously, there are some people who triplets would just be a blessing because they've been waiting for so long. So certainly, I think that it is really up to you and whether or not you're ready to take on that risk. Obviously, the vast majority of pregnancies are still singleton pregnancies, but there definitely is a risk that you need to be aware of. And so we'll do that every month. And again, you know, if you're not, haven't started your period by day 35, at that point, you know, we want you to take a pregnancy test. And if your pregnancy test is positive,
hopefully
that's the case. Exactly. Mm-hmm. And if it's negative, then at that point, if you haven't, don't start your cycle on your own, we can help you start your cycle again and do the Clomid again. And like I said, I usually try to work my patients to a dose to where they're ovulating. And then once they're ovulating, I usually try to do it for about 4 to 6 months, trying to hit that 20% every month. You know, if we can give you about 4 to 6 months, we should get you pretty close to a good chance of getting pregnant. If it's not happening after that, it may be time to see that reproductive endocrinologist and infertility specialist, or REI, okay? So REI is usually where we would go after that. And at that point, there's multiple other things they can do. So they can do other medications that include things like injections to help you ovulate and time your ovulation better. And then they can also do things where they'll potentially put the sperm straight into the uterus for you with a timed ovulation to hopefully help you get pregnant. They can also do things like in vitro fertilization, where they actually will take out several of your eggs with kind of what we call super ovulation, where they kind of make you ovulate a lot. So they'll take out a lot of your eggs and then mix it with sperm and then re-implant a fertilized egg into you. And there are actually lots of variations on that theme that they can do in order to help you get pregnant. And then, of course, there's always things like egg donation and sperm donation and things like that as well. If you're getting to that point where we really just can't make it happen with one of the partners. You know, one of the things that I tell a lot of people is once it gets to that point where you've tried things and every month is just such an utter disappointment, and you really, for a lot of couples, they get to the point where they just don't feel like they can do it anymore. It's too much of a stress on their system. I always encourage people, don't take it as a failure or as you're giving up to do something like adoption. There are so many children out there in the world that really need loving homes. And to do that, not only are you giving yourself the family that you want, but you're also helping an innocent child who needs help. So I think for a lot of people, that can be a really nice way to get the family that they want. It's not necessarily everything that you wanted, because you don't have that genetic bond, but you can't have a loving, healthy family. Mm-hmm. And as you stated, sometimes people, once they finally give up on trying to get pregnant, they get pregnant, and stress certainly does seem to play a role. In fact, stress plays so much of a role that some clinics will give women massages before they do IVF, because it's actually been shown to improve how well things implant, because just having everything relaxed seems to help with implantation. So absolutely, as much as you can manage your stress, because we know you can't really de-stress as much as we would all like to, trying to manage that stress can be really helpful.